Good evening, gentlemen. And let's go ahead and dive in. We are looking at the three dimensions of spiritual warfare, and they're all laid out in different ways in scripture. And so last week we looked at the flesh component, which is, for most of us, it's kind of a constant battle. It's within us, right? And we have, as Paul said, well, wretched man than I am. And we have this tug of war going on. Secondly, there is just the world system. And right now, the world system for almost anyone that's breathing and can actually finish a cognitive thought is crazy. We knew it was broken and that the world's a mess, but we've got some people with medical illness that are trying to take over the asylum. And it's a scary season. I don't know if you feel that. I feel that more on my chest or on my heart, a sense of grieving. That I'm usually not a great big 4th of July. I got like one 4th of July shirt. I've had it for 12 years. You know, I wear it to the fireworks, and that's pretty much it. I'll sing along with Lee Greenwood, you know. I'm proud to be an American because I love the song, but I've had my eyes wide open to the some of the frailty and hypocrisies of our history for a while. But doggone it, man, I'm gonna do America this time. I'm buying a flag. I'm gonna be doing it. I feel the tension of how it, for the first time, seems to be under threat. It's not on the outside, it's on the inside. And so the good thing to mention about the world, because we looked at the orchestra last time, right on this here, the orchestra of the devil, all of the principalities and powers working in harmony and playing the same song. They're playing in a different key, but they're playing the same song as the world system, playing the same song and the same flute, drawing us like the Pied Piper into the world. And then the devil binding us once we move towards worldliness, or once we cave to our flesh and we give a place to the devil. And all these things are warning for us in scripture directly from Jesus. Neither give place to the devil. Don't give him a handle. And I've done that, you know, in some decades of my life where I gave him a place and was like, you know, like a house. If you look at, you know, the scripture talks about a man without city wall is like a man without self-control is like a city with broken down walls. If you look at it as a household, you know, what's going on in your laundry room? Is that a stronghold where the enemy has taken some ground and he's built his nest and he's laying eggs that we don't know, looking at our body as kind of like the compartments? And men are better at compartmentalizing, you know what I'm talking about. And so we're kind of like, we're going to nail the door shut the best we can, but then we hear that thing beating on the door, trying to break in and take over the guest bedroom, right? And so there's that struggle for us to, we're at war. And so really, life is a warfare. It's not the full containment of life. Life is love. Life is family. Life is fun. Life is dead serious. Life is learning. Life is entertainment. But in all of that, there's that constant, not just the threat of, but the presence of war and battle. And we're going to learn now, we're going to go into the third component, and that is the airwaves. And so we have the world, the flesh, and the devil. And this region around our planet and touching our planet, you know, there's a place where it says about Job, where the sons of God and Satan came and had a discourse with God. And he was walking to and fro on the earth. And so we know that demonic forces, principalities and powers, and that Satan has access to walk to and fro on the earth. He went and talked and tempted Jesus when he was on that mountain, rough mountains of the wilderness. And his presence is not so much focused on you, he's focused on his peeps. And he's focused on the orchestra. Some people say the devil made me do this and Satan made me do that. And it's really his system his kingdom made up of entities. And these entities have a residence, like an atmosphere. So in the atmosphere, you know, we say heavenly places back then, but it's the same thing. The atmosphere is a residence where the enemy has pockets of control and in fact is in control. And within that ring around the earth and touching the earth are layers of authority. And then it ends. And then once it ends, outside of that is not only the universe, but outside of that is the heavens itself, where God rules and reigns in complete, free, and unhindered authority. It's only when he sends an angel like he did in Daniel 9, where there was this dream that Daniel had, one of the two archangels came and has to do battle in the atmosphere over a prince who was hovering over Persia, a huge kingdom at that time, the most powerful kingdom in the world at that time. And they were doing battle and wrestling as Daniel was fasting and praying. So we see a dynamic of entry and back. And we are walking around as, you know, sometimes you see those people going down those hills and those great big bubbles and they're rolling down, right? We're in a kind of a bubble that wherever we go, the kingdom goes. But the beautiful thing is that as we become more cognitive, we also leave behind the wake of the kingdom. And so we take ground, and we take ground together as men who learn to pray together, cover each other's six, and all the great things that happen, and be praying for our families and, of course, with our spouses and kids as necessary. So these demonic forces are called principalities, and some scriptures often thrones. Spiritual wickedness in high places, or spiritual evil, is the atmosphere. It's a place of deep pollution, because the beings themselves are deeply polluted. They're filled with hatred and murder and strife and chaos and confusion. And they're out there to afflict and to inflict through the spirit of fear and controlling people through the fear of rejection. These are some of their primary tools that we need to become more familiar with. And we feel that someone, maybe a beloved family member, has a bad day and you step on their toe in the wrong way and they come at you, and man, that sword goes right into your heart because the enemy activated that. And you want to strike back at that person. And oftentimes, if we're not understanding that maybe what we felt at that moment was an intense wound in our own heart of rejection that we suffered from a memory that we can't even access. But the enemy knows where those buttons are to strike, to wound, to tempt, to lure, to drive into depression, to drive into some other happy oasis where we can satisfy a release of our stressors. All this stuff is going on all the time. And I don't want us to think that blah, 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 you know, it's all the time like that. God gives us the ability to get things done and do our job and spend time with our families. But this is a key component of what it means to be a man. We are the watchmen for our families. And we can see now with the fatherlessness pandemic that families have been unprotected far too long. And men, young men now, have been weaponized in their own self-hatred and by the spirit of rejection. So let's become fluent in the languages and the weaponry and the strategies and the tactics of what's going on. You know, I think sometimes we want to muster up bravado and people start, you know, we're going to do this in Jesus' name, and they kind of change their voices and try to, you know, it's kind of like whistling in the dark. It's not that. It's competence plus confidence. And I mean self-confidence, but self-confidence that is confident in Christ and confidence and competence in the Word of God. And having the wisdom to be interlocked in relationships with a couple of other guys. We'll introduce 911s in a few minutes and what that relationship looks like. And we've already been practicing that without naming it in our troikas. So these demonic forces, fortunately for us, are somewhat disorganized. They do not have power directly over us. They have power to insinuate, to intimidate, to whisper words of self-condemnation, to remind us that we are rejected, that we're unworthy. Just like Gideon was going through, he was alone and he was isolated and he felt that that no one loved him like we feel sometimes, or no one wants to spend time with them. They felt marginalized. He felt disqualified, DQ'd, until God freed him and adopted him and opened his mouth. He then became a weapon for righteousness by the Lord and in relationship. And so let's always strive to learn. Just like you say, well, I have a friend of mine who's one of the four Caucasian ninth level, I'll get this right, judo champions in the world. He's won two silver medals in the Olympics in the late 60s. And this guy is always thinking that way. He's still a trainer and he's in a very elite core. There's only some 30 or five or so masters at that level. And that is the top level that exists. And so we need to start thinking like this, because he knows how to protect and he knows how to train others. And that's in more of a practical way. So a couple other words that you'll see is that sometimes they're lords with a small L. Sons of God, they're used sometimes in the Old Testament. The Nephilim from the book of Genesis during Noah's time. And strong man, like we see the strong man, the Prince of Persia, Jesus preached about the strong man, about how we need to guard, be on guard, so that the strong man won't come in. Now, you go, you know, why are we getting into all this stuff? What about all the other aspects of, you know, 1 Corinthians 13 and all that kind of stuff? The thing is, a ready man will rarely be attacked by an inferior being. And so the enemy is so arrogant and proud and afraid, because he not only can cast fear, our enemies can cast fear, but many times if you sense that fear is happening around you, it's actually the passing of a demonic force through your living room or across your sidewalk, and you're feeling their fear of you. Now, that's a change in mindset. You're feeling their fear of you. And the more that we are men, and it's not about abracadabra in the name of Jesus. Jesus's name is not a trick. It's not a potion. It comes out of our hearts. Because we know that we are ambassadors and adopted sons of the fathers, and we operate on earth as his agents in his name. Like someone could go and be an ambassador in the name of the King of England. Right? Or it's been the queen for a long time now. And so we're ambassadors. And that confidence creates not only an awareness and a discernment as we grow in it, but it keeps the enemy away. This is the most amazing truth. And if we will learn, right now I'm not a martial arts guy. You know, my body's pretty broken. My reactions are way off what they were. Balance is an issue, you know, not, you know, whether I'm going to get in a certain kind of a stance. Yoga's a joke. I'm not a dangerous person in the world. And sometimes I'll think, you know, gosh, I wish when I was younger, I would have learned this and kept up some discipline. I'd feel more confident when I happen to find myself in the back alley or in the dark street. I've never needed that. But we all need that sense of confidence and readiness in the spirit. And this is why this whole course is being taught, so that we master that in order to enjoy the life that God has for us. These demons are fearful of Jesus. They're fearful of believers who believe, fearful of believers who understand and practice their position in Christ. And we're going to talk about that in just a minute. Ray, would you like to go ahead and read this out? And let's look at this as if we're looking at this verse for the first time, all right? Let's try to refresh our minds and do a reboot real quick and say, I'm reading this for the first time.
Very good. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 through 13. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms.
Amen. Amen. Underline the devil's schemes. This word schemes goes all the way back to Genesis 3, where the narrator or the author of the book, which most people believe and Jesus affirmed was Moses, he said he's more crafty, he's more wary, he's more dangerous than he looks. He's constantly scheming in wicked thoughts about how to gain advantage, how to intimidate, how to gain control of, how to drive a person into more misery, how to drive a person off the cliff, literally, or to take someone with them. He's scheming all of the time, and we can't compete with that. But we can learn strategy, we can learn tactics, and we can stay close to Jesus, because the creator of this crafty, the craftiest being in all of creation, was God. So the only one that's craftier than the devil is God. And he's in us. He's the guy, he's like the guy in the street. He's gonna tip us off and let us know what's going down. You know, the robbery tomorrow night. The Holy Spirit is in us because he's craftier. And I love the story between Mordecai and Haman. There's a classic struggle of good versus evil and pride and arrogance. And you could actually say that would be a man of God like Mordecai was, and actually a demon. Haman just personified and was completely controlled by some sort of a satanic demon. So these are a few scriptures here. I mentioned Daniel 9, it's actually Daniel 10. I'd like you to go and go through these for the sake of time. But I would like to stop just a moment for the difference between being demonized. It's like the word demon possessed in scripture, where Jesus was coming against something, or demon influence, doesn't mean that the person is completely controlled by. You have to really get to that ninth level or whatever it is, like the Gadarene demoniac who they bound with chains and had superhuman strength and broke the chains. You know, multiple men would try to control him and he couldn't. The five sons of Sceva that tried to mix it up in Jesus' name, but they didn't have the card. They weren't in the club. They weren't believers. But they heard Paul throw Jesus' name around. He goes, we can do this too, make some money by casting demons out. Well, that one demon in that man that they were trying to set free took on those five men and tore off all their clothes and beat the tar out of them, and they fled naked to the streets. It's not a good day. And so, but for most of us, if you're a believer, we've been sealed by the Holy Spirit, so our spirit cannot be possessed. But our soul and our mind and our thinking can be highly influenced by that, by listening to narratives, following the dark horse down the dark alley in our thoughts, thinking the worst, believing the worst, and having fear triggered can put us into a place where we actually can start developing mental illnesses, or believing, and the enemy wants to rob and kill and to destroy. So he may not be able to kill you, but he can bring destruction around your life, and he can rob your joy. He can rob the life God has for you. He can rob you of your marriage. He can rob you of relationship with your kids or your future or the best career for you. And so in that activity, we have scriptures that are in there to teach us warfare and teach us how to think in those situations. So the word demon possessed is not a biblical word. I think we understand, we've known of people that were institutionalized that may have, now medicine wants to say it's all some biochemical thing, but the origin could very well have been years and years of unforgiveness and bitterness. And just as our mental and our heart condition, as far as our caring for ourselves and others, has a great impact in our mental health and in our emotional and spiritual health, those things come together. And we know that there's a place where the enemy can be given a handhold and be given a place where he gets a grip, and then his tentacles begin to expand if we're not aware, if we're undercover, if we're out from God's will, and if we haven't been trained. So us being close together, like that scene in Gladiators, come together, lock your shields, as one, that's why and how we can win together. Amen?
Amen. I watched Gladiator the other night, Art. I watched that scene. Yeah, it was cool.
It's a great scene. It's a great scene. Okay. So one final thing. In Africa, we're dealing with a principality, and it's some sort of a tribalism. It's over much of the Middle East, most of Northern Africa, and then there's like a different entity in Sub-Sahara Africa. And this tribal demon, this strong man, this definitely a principality or a power over almost an entire continent. And there may be two or three different players we encountered it by accident. And so there are regional demonic entities that grip a population. We have them here in our country. We could throw out a few guesses. There's a couple of new ones have been sticking up their head of late that I never thought I'd see. And so recognize that we as the church are called to go and invade darkness and to embrace, invade the impossible as a unit, not as heroes. This is not, you know, special forces that we're going to send Mike, you know, we're going to send Jason Bourne to solve this problem. That's not the way God works. So we can begin as men and to join in prayer in our churches or with other women and or within our own family and together to identify. And then we agree, we begin, this is the weapons of our warfare unto the pulling down of strongholds. The destruction is the word of strongholds. It's like to take a medicine ball and throw it down hard on the ground. It's a violent act. And Jesus said the kingdom of heaven must suffer violence, but only the violent ones will take it by force. That's us. That's us. And most people in the church go, I don't know what that means. I don't want to know what that means. No, those are the guys that are winning. Those are the guys that are taking new ground. Those are the guys that are changing lives and changing villages and communities and cities and even nations. And so if you want to be a player, you got to have this magazine on. You know, you got to have your ammo and you got to know how to use it. And so familiarity with it is our objective. And this is just, you know, this is a relatively short course, but longer than what many of you may have ever experienced before. So I wanted to introduce this. And so you see a picture here of the flesh and the world, and I've taken the principalities and powers and brought them closer down. This is about the best graphic artist you're gonna see from me, okay? But I found a decent shot of Jesus on the throne, and we know that he's been raised up in the heavenly places and high above all authority, thrones, principalities, powers, and dominion, and all glory and all honor is now unto him because he gave his life. The Father has poured all the glory that Jesus abandoned when he became that single zygote and was inseminated into Mary's womb. He abandoned everything except his character and his nature. He got it all back and then some. We don't know how much more, but there, you know, he was elevated back to co-regent ruling and reigning with the Father and has his own throne. And we don't have clarity exactly what that was before, but he's the man, he's the dude. And so I got this picture of him on his throne. This is in him, he's been on this throne, and it says he ever lives to intercede for us. So his number one job is to be praying for and intervening for us in heaven, in conjunction with the Holy Spirit on earth in us, for communities, for nations, for individual brokers, for the lost, for the poor, for the fatherless, for the widows in their distress, for the prisoners, for those that have broken hearts. Jesus identified what his own ministry was about in his first 1-minute sermon, right? From Isaiah. And so that's our gig too. And so we can move with authority as rescuing agents. And in order to do that, you want to get someone out of the prison of their bondage, you gotta go in, man. You gotta go in like a Navy SEAL. You gotta go in shock and awe and confidence. And so a real important scripture is in Ephesians chapter 2. And Ray, if you have that at your fingertips, go ahead and read it. If you know the one I'm talking about, Ephesians is really a lock and load theology book about relationships, and particularly this relationship that we have in spiritual authority.
I'll start in verse 8. I like the grammar there. To me, the very least of all saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unfathomable riches of Christ, and to bring to light what is the administration of the mystery for which for ages has been hidden in God who created all things, in order that the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known through the church to the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose which he carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen, amen. The actual verse was a little bit further up in the notes, Ray, in the new version. But that's a majestic verse that got, you know, needs books written about it and entire 12-week courses too. But let me read this, because this is our hope, guys, as to why we're destined to win. Not just get in and mix it up. Not just rumble, we're destined to win. Even as we, and I'm looking at Ephesians 2, verse 5. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. Now, take a look at this throne right here, because that's where Jesus is. He's not on earth. He's in his physical body, resurrected. Sound theology says that he doesn't show up here. The Holy Spirit shows up, which is called the Spirit of Christ throughout the New Testament. And we say, I feel Jesus, and we worship Jesus. And there is a connection there directly to him, of course, because God's not bound by our space. Even when we're dead in our trespasses, by grace you have been saved. And he raised us up with him, seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. It also says in several other places that all authority and power and all demonic forces that God is putting all the enemies in this book of Psalms, the enemies under our feet, and that on all authorities and all powers are under the feet of Jesus. This verse says a clear theological reality that we've been translated in our spirit to have dual residencies here on earth as an ambassador, but in heaven as our citizenship. As a citizen and son, we've been given the same authority that Jesus has, and we have been seated with him in heavenly places. And so I made up a little graphic here, which I thought might give us a little bit of a picture. And it's a little silhouette of a boy. And so he is seated with Christ. And when you and I deal with something big, we deal with something that is of our concern. We need to understand that our legal standing is, you know, we have that Abba Father. We have that Jesus is our regent. He is our captain, our general, our king. That everything we do and say, we operate under his same authority. Same authority. And just as the embassy for the United States government of Kenya is in Nairobi, that is U.S. soil. And so we carry U.S. soil here on earth where we go, not U.S. soil, maybe as a citizen traveler, but we carry kingdom soil, heavenly soil, and we have that authority. Now, why is this so important? It's good theology, but really, Art, what does it mean? It means this. It means that we've been raised with him in heavenly places. That the reality of spiritual warfare is you have a choice to pray up to God like Daniel was doing. Oh God, rescue me, help me. Do bad things to the enemy. He's coming in like a flood. Or And a couple of quotes by Carl von Clausewitz, one of my guys. He talks about higher ground. And a lot of generals, if we have writing from them, we always talk about, you got to have the higher ground. If you have you'll lose big percentage points of winning a battle or a skirmish or a war between nations. If you don't consistently have the higher ground, you're not surprised. There's not surprise attacks because you're ready and you're thinking ahead like a great chessman would do. And so von Clausewitz said, historically, most armies, now he loved higher ground. It was like a big deal for him. And he wanted dominion wherever he went. That was one of his favorite words. And this is a guy around, the late 1700s, early 1800s. He's fighting a contemporary fighting Napoleon for the Prussian army. Historically, most armies with a higher ground at the battle site in the beginning will win that battle. We have the higher ground. The perspective, the general can see any movement of troops going on in the battle from his position and send messengers and move squads and move flanks and attack weak points because he has the higher ground. It's easier to defend down than up. How many times you've heard a football commentator say, man, that running back, he's running downhill all day long, right? And you actually can feel that. It's momentum, but it's also position. And in football is blocking and tackling, which we can be for each other. And then gravity. Downhill attacks have much more power and momentum, and they're compelling and they're intimidating. See, the enemy wants us to think that we're praying up and he's somewhere up there doing bad things. No way, guys. We have the higher ground. And this is the critical missing piece in how we pray. Started appealing. Jesus doesn't go, hey, Father, there's some problems down on earth. And I was wondering if you got a couple of minutes, maybe we can help take care of these crazies looting stores in Los Angeles, Jesus just, he does it, right? We know that. He already crushed the enemy. Well, he crushed the enemy for us too. That's our legacy, not just his. And so it's a mind frame change. And if we can grip this, when I just learned this principle in the last 2 or 3 years in Africa, and I realized that if we're going to ever make a difference there, we're going to have to come with the higher ground. We're going to have to come with attitude, but not just cockiness and swag. We're going to have to come with real truth and really believe. So we began training the men and saying, listen, guys, you have the higher ground. We're praying down to these principalities and powers that have been there for tens of thousands of years, crippling lives, destroying lives, causing pain and suffering, sacrificing babies, all of the wickedness and the witchcraft. They've had their day. Their day is over, and we're coming after them. And here's the crazy thing. Our guys, they're all pastors. Most of them are pastors and stuff, and some are just civilians, so to speak. But they believe it. And the enemy is backing off. He's pulling away. And it's like there's a vacuum drawing us in. We're held back really essentially not by manpower, but by funding. And I'm actually happy for that because it's just really exhausting. You don't just fight like a Taras Bulba, right? You don't do it. You don't just do a Alexander the Great and you just war for 11 years and then die drunk. This is a battle that always has to have the kingdom being established. The government is behind us, just as it was the Roman army. This is the purpose of the church, guys, to rescue the downtrodden and the broken and the prisoners and the weak. But it's an assault. It's an assault for those of us who believe in the power of prayer, but the power of prayer is downhill, downhill. So I want to break into a troika right now. I want you guys to talk with each other about that. Talk about that paradigm. Can you dig it? I mean, can you actually make this a part of your life? I tell you, it's changed my life. It's changed my sense of authority. And it was always there. It was always true. Okay? So what I really want you to do is let me see if I have a troika coming up. That's just too awesome for us to not just take a, talk about this. Talk about this verse, Ephesians 6, 2:6. And then we're going to go right into the I think there's 12 different, we're going to do the anatomy of Satan so we understand him better and the way he thinks. So in with the higher ground, we can also project what he's going to do next. Now that's exciting stuff, where we rule and reign with Christ. All right. So go ahead, Al, and break them up, and we'll probably have the results for you when we get back. Are there any questions first? Good call. All right, let's just do like 12 minutes. We'll come out of this at around 5 after.
And what's the question we're supposed to, that you posed?
Okay, here's the question. How will you pray differently from higher ground? You may already be doing this. What difference does it make to you psychologically and spiritually in your faith that we're praying downhill? What does that mean to you? And talk about the way you've been praying thus far. And by the way, not all prayers are downhill prayers. In the priest course, we look at 16 different techniques of prayer that are laid out in scripture. And it's not boring, but they're all tools that we can have. There's supplication. We're asking God for food. We're asking him for a favor. Not everything is involving principalities and powers, so don't get me wrong. But when it is, when there's blockades that you feel are in the spiritual realm, that's when we strap it on in heaven and we pull down the strongholds, okay? So how do you pray now? And how can you pray now in the future when you're dealing with these dark obstacles in your life, all right?
All right, guys. So,
oh, we're in trouble now.
I appreciate you, Art, and you know the time and effort that you put in to put this together, the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
To think through the organization, right? And as Art mentioned, and some of you may be familiar, when you're trying to win a game that involves strategy. You know, football, basketball, baseball, those team sports, even the sport that I coach in wrestling, when you're trying to win, it's good to understand the strategy, the technique of your opponent. You find out what makes them tick, what's going to make them give up. And so we want to embark in a little study on the origins of evil, some of the things that are true about Satan, but not to lift him up, not to give him any credence.
Amen.
He is a defeated foe, right? And it does make a difference in our prayer lives, the way we behave, the way we combat sin in our lives, the way we view conflicts with other Christians, understanding that he is defeated, that God has already won the victory, right? Kevin and I were talking about the fact that, you know, that scripture is very clear that Jesus is a master over sin and death.
Hmm.
Right? And the resurrection proves it. And that guy lives inside of each one of us.
Hmm.
So let's approach this topic with that authority and understanding that he holds no sway over us.
Amen.
He can try, and unfortunately, right? There's a difference between positional holiness and progressive holiness. We're still in the progressive part. So let me read a paragraph out of this really cool book that I found in my shelf. The author's name is Art Hobba. Just about the origins of evil. And I like the way that he lays it out, right? The Bible teaches that eons ago, the devil or Satan had attempted to take over the throne of God in heaven. He was jealous, right? He raised a following of 1/3 of the angelic host, and together they were cast down out of heaven by God. Sometime after this, according to Genesis chapters 1 and 2, God created man in his image, male and female, and placed them in a glorious garden. He then gave man dominion over all the earth and everything it contained. However, it was an authority delegated by God to man, not intrinsic to Adam. Over this world called earth, he was made the ruling steward, and that just increased Satan's jealousy. And it was like a poison that continued to influence him. So if you look in your manuals, you'll see a big list under the title, Devil Frequently Asked Questions. There's 15 of them, 15 points, and we're just going to briefly discuss them. We have a little bit more than 20 minutes to finish, and we've got about an hour and a half material. Because there is a lot to study. There is a lot to understand. So number one, his power over Christians has been broken, right? Teachings of Jesus Christ, New Testament writers clearly illustrate this, right? As we just read, we are now, this very moment, seated with Christ in the heavenlies. Now, even though we're in the heavenlies, we're still at the foot of the throne and we're still looking up to him, right? He's our provider. Number two, Satan is an old, patient, and relentless schemer, right? He will never give up. If we're going to match his intensity, we need to understand that. He's going to try, and he won't stop, to chip away our resolve. And he has great plans for us, right? Not plans for our health, for our benefit. Number three, he is the original rebel against authority, right? He's the source of all this rebellion that we see in society, the rebellion against authority, pulling down statues. Number four, his heart is filled with war, right? When Japan attacked Pearl Harbor, the appropriate reaction of our government was a formal declaration of war, right?
Yeah.
Why don't our churches make that same declaration against Satan? Right? There is no truce, there is no rest, no reprieve in this war against the saints. He is going to fight until he's cast by God into the lake of fire. Number five, he is a liar and the father of all lies. That's why it's so important to study the truth, to know God's word. Have it hidden in our hearts, right? If he can reach a child and train a child to be fearful and mistrust authority early on, it's going to be very difficult for that child to grow up and be a strong believer. Number six, he is not omnipotent, right? He's a broken shadow of the angel that he once was. He can do a lot of crazy things, but he's not all powerful. God is. Number seven, he's not omnipresent, right? I think this is particularly important to understand and be able to discount untruths that people think about the devil and about Satan. As a singular created being, he must work strategically through the tactics of shoring up an evil world system that plays to erudite, high-sounding, proud philosophies and the basest parts of our carnal nature. Doesn't that sound like politics today?
Yeah.
Number eight, he is not omniscient. He doesn't know our thoughts. He has thousands of years of experience with our predictable fallen nature, right? He knows how to dangle the juiciest steak in front of the hungriest dog, but he doesn't know everything. He doesn't know our silent prayers. He doesn't know what's going on in our heart through the power of the Holy Spirit. He is also the author of death, right? There's an apocryphal book of wisdom that was written a century before Jesus' birth, which aptly says, by the envy of the devil, death entered the world, and they who are in his possession experience it, envy. He is a murderer, right? All the violence, the looting that we saw, this is all Satan's influence. You think about whoever it was that organized, was so organized they could deliver bricks to every one of the riot places at the same time across the United States so that the rioters would have ammunition. What is that? 11, and I like the way you worded this, Art. He is much smarter than a fifth grader, and thus you or me. As Eve discovered, it is dangerous to dialogue with him. Even the most powerful of angelic forces, the archangel Michael, when God assigned him to retrieve the body of Moses, did not affront Satan directly, but had to employ God's direct authority by declaring, "The Lord rebuke you." We are very wise to understand that, employ that. You and I, we can't stand up. By ourselves, we're weak. We're not that smart. Given the wisdom of the word and the position that we have with God's authority because of the blood of Jesus Christ, we have incredible strength. Number 12, he hates women. He has an active plan to destroy their humanity, femininity, motherhood, beauty, glory, the female gender's great influence for love, courage, wisdom, and all that is good. He hates children. The passion of his fatherhood, right, is to make liars first and then disciples of hell. Right? Just as the great evils that we saw in history, Khmer Rouge, fascism, Nazism, communism, they take the young and inoculate them with propaganda. Number 14, and hear me. This is important for us as men. He hates us. He hates men and most of all, and boys. Which, of course, primary reason for Art to write this book. We know that our love accomplishes much in the lives of others. We know that our words have great healing power, great encouragement, but they can also be dangerous and demeaning. And then lastly, number 15, we need to understand his overarching strategy, right? Just like it's a big game of chess. My sport wrestling that I coach is called physical chess. And we're always coaching the guys to think three moves ahead, right? If you just react, you're going to be the slow wrestler, the slow competitor. So think three moves ahead. What's your opponent doing? How can you set him up? How can you protect yourself? How can you stay in good, grounded position? That's your foundation. You know, we have a tendency, I think, because of the great foundation of our country and the blessings that we have of God, to forget how evil Satan's influence can be, right? And this is a pretty graphic illustration, but I want to take it right out of Art's book about an excavation that was undertaken in the northern part of Lebanon, right? 1929, excavations began in the ancient port town of Ugarit in northern Lebanon. The remains of a palace were discovered in the first year of excavation. It yielded a library containing hundreds of ancient documents that provided a wealth of information about the Canaanite religion. What did these tablets reveal? The texts show the degrading results of the worship of those idols, right? It said that the altar of Baal was in the image of a double-horned bull, with the head and shoulders of a man. Later it evolved into a completely human form, but retained the two horns of the head. Its arms extended outward as a stoked fire belched out from a hole in its chest. As a requirement of devotion for each family and to receive the blessing of God, the priest of Baal would demand that one of their children be made a sacrifice. When the child was handed over, it would be placed on the outstretched arms of the idol, red hot from the heat, where the child could then be rolled into the fire. In Baal worship, as the child raised its final screams, the frenzied priests, and priestesses would openly engage in hetero and homosexual intercourse. Finally, the balance of the worshipers would then complete the ceremony by engaging in orgasmic ritual. What did what were the results of that in this ancient community? A more recent excavation of a site of Baal worship contained the remains of more than 20,000 children. This was the religion that God had warned the Israelites to avoid. And it really, the sacrificing of children is really the result of idol worship. As mankind goes down the path of going farther and farther from God's truth, the innocence and the value of each life, the more at risk our children are. And unfortunately, it continues today in the form of abortion. If you think about how many children are aborted because a couple wanted the pleasure of sex before marriage, before the responsibility, or didn't want to take the responsibility of a child born, it's sacrifice on the altar of commercialism and selfism. When we talk about Satan and we go to examine his strategy, you know, who he is, it helps to understand how he's been described, right? Some of the names that arose in the worship, the early worship of Baal, were Baal Gad, or the Lord of Good Fortune, right? The world system will always have us bet on the get-rich-quick scheme, right? What morals have we sacrificed on the altar of good fortune? Baal is also named Baal Peor, or the Lord of the Opening, right? The God of the Opening of the Midianites. Like lawless pirates, they simply took advantage of any opportunity or, quote, opening, unquote, that presented an advantage to them. The opening is offered to us as the church when we use manipulation to get someone to give more or to volunteer or to become a Christian. We don't allow the Holy Spirit to move on them or the congregation or a family member. If we seize or leverage an opportune opening, it's common in business, and often it's preceded by a bluff or a lie, direct lie, to set up your opponent and create that opening. We're sacrificing our integrity on the altar of truth, right? Baal has also been called the Lord, Baal Berith, the Lord of Covenants or Contracts, right? The people of the time would grow accustomed to making a contract or a covenant with this Baal figure. They carried small figurines in their pockets as good luck charms. Does that sound familiar to anyone? Baal has also been called Baal Haman, or the Lord of Wealth, right? in the parable of the sower, which, you know, Jesus so eloquently teaches us, the seed that was sown among the weeds initially sprouted with promise, but soon the cares or the anxiety of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choked it out. Baal was called Baal Hazor. And we can finish the rest of these. I know time is coming to an end, and we want to close on time. But the point being, as we consider the origins of evil and some of Satan's characters, we have to also understand how he tempts us. And he tempts us in various ways. And as men of truth, as we grow in our strength and our faith, we want to prepare ourselves to stand up to those schemes. Thanks, Art.
I got had to unmute. Ray, that was great. It was a great walkthrough. I'm still figuring out this Zoom. And if you didn't see, I'd never had a chance because of time to let Ray know that we wanted to finish with a short video clip that some of you have seen to kind of accentuate this time to get us to be oriented for our next session together. And we'll pick up, and Ray will be happy to do that. We'll work out where we do this again together next time. But we're going to go deep into these Baals, and that's the way that I say it. But there's actually an apostrophe right between B-A and A-L. So probably need to go to the Hebrew dictionary to figure out which one it is. But the symbolism of these different Baals that Israel kept getting sucked into is absolutely current in today's society. And unfortunately, it's very prevalent and uncalled. It's not being called out in the church because, I mean, I spent almost 40 years of my Christian walk as a disciple thinking that, you know, the Old Testament is not really relevant. They're always worshiping these pieces of wood or stone or statues, and God gets all ticked off. And I don't understand what that's about. Of course, there's nothing like that today. Nobody bows before statues and that sort of thing. But it's very, very, very real. And since the first book was written, various other books have come out about what is this hidden idolatry that we have. And it is hidden. None of us want to go and worship other idols, but it's prevalent. It's prevalent. We are, unfortunately, we are systemically polytheists. And Ray will pick up on that some more next time. I want to show you this clip, and I just want to let it settle. And here's why I'm showing it to you. It's from the movie Fireproof. And I want you to capture the rage in Kirk Cameron's mind and in his heart and his eyes in particular, when he realizes that this parasitic thing had taken over his life and insidiously swept in and divided him and his wife. And so this is not a lesson about pornography, though it is the prevalent thing that shames men in the church and outside the church. In fact, now there's been a huge movement, a secular movement to ban pornography for what it does physiologically and psychologically to a man who is addicted to. And it can be addicting. It works with our own body chemistry. So this character played by this fireman played by Kirk Cameron had to access emotion. And next week when we meet, I want you to be ready to access that emotion, because the Holy Spirit will disclose to you in your reading and also in the teaching next week where you have strongholds in the area of the Baals. These are substitutes for Yahweh that we feed off of, that we gain gratification from, that we gain masculinity from, that we gain the feeling of success from, and where we pour out our time. So as you reflect, and you have in your workbook there the core conditioning, go ahead and do that. I want you to capture this emotion and bring it with you next week, all right? It's a powerful time, something we're going to do together. We've never done it by video before, but let me go ahead and bring this video up and get us to the right spot. And I will see you guys next week. Let me do this share screen thing. Sorry about that. You might want to turn up your audio. You can't hear anything now, but I'm turning it up here. Maybe quiet. We've got the subtitles on as well.
Day 23. Watch out for parasites. The parasite is anything that latches onto you or your partner and sucks the life out of your marriage. They're usually in the form of addictions like gambling, drugs, or pornography. They promise pleasure, but grow like a disease and consume more and more of your thoughts, time, and money. They steal away your loyalty and heart from those you love. Marriage is rarely survived if parasites are present. If you love your wife, you must destroy any addiction that has your heart. If you don't, it will destroy you. Okay, Lord, no more addictions.
Mr. Rudolph?
Caleb?
You doing okay today?
No, not really.
Irma, I know what you're talking to that guy. He is weird.
I wanted to know more.
Okay. Well, brothers, we will see you next week. If you happen to run into any of the other guys online, this next week in your core conditioning is an exhortation to find in your life two men and ask them to be two men that you have a trusting relationship with. It may not be all it could be, but you trust them enough to invite them into your life and vice versa. And it's called 911 Buddies. These are guys you call. These are guys that call you. Maybe 3 a.m, maybe never at night. But something's going down. Something takes you blindsided. Something takes them the same way. Happens to all of us. You give them a call. You pray with each other over the phone. You're there for that person. And that person is your shield mate and will understand how those shields work for effective warfare and battle in the weeks ahead. So God bless you. And I'll see you all next week.